Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence in relation to an inquiry into Scotland's Commissioner Landscape. We are joined in the room by Audrey Nicholl, Convener of the Criminal Justice Committee, and Claire Hoggie, Convener of the Health and Sports Committee, joins us remotely. I welcome you both to the meeting and good morning. I intend to allow around an hour for this session and we're going to move straight to questions. So I'd like to begin, Audrey, by asking you about the report on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, in which you said, and I quote, "We remain to be convinced that a strong case has been made for the establishment of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. Instead, we consider that better outcomes may be achieved by focusing spending in areas which have more direct and immediate benefit for victims and witnesses." So I'm just wondering how the committee kind of arrived at that conclusion.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to attend this morning. So, as you've set out, the Criminal Justice Committee engaged in fairly extensive scrutiny of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. Six parts, a significant bill. Part one being the proposal to create a position of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. So we took evidence from a range of witnesses, organisations who are already involved in supporting victims and witnesses, bodies within the justice system already, and a number of lived experience witnesses. So I think there were a few issues that came out in the evidence that we heard, which led us to conclude that we, as you say, we remained to be convinced about the case to create the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner post. So if I can just run through two or three of them. I think the first was in and around duplication. So as I said earlier on, there are a number of bodies that already support and do significant support work, in particular around victims of sexual crime. And one of the issues that came up there was the potential for a commissioner to overlap, if you like, with or perhaps intrude on the work that is already being done extensively by existing bodies. And in fact, Scottish Women's Aid commented that they felt that the relationships that they have with likes of Scottish Government policymakers are already very good and very productive. And in fact, Scotland is held as a bit of a standout in that regard. The next issue probably was in and around the cost. So obviously the financial memorandum set out start-up costs of I think around about 640,000 and then recurring costs after that. And there was certainly a feeling that those costs could potentially be put to better use. And I think as Sandy Brindley from Rape Crisis Scotland commented, she would rather see resource going to supporting a victim around legal representation than perhaps supporting a victim and witnesses commissioner. So those were a couple of the key points that came up in our evidence. I think the third point I would mention was around the potential overlap of a victims and witnesses commissioner with existing commissioners. And that specifically came up in and around the role of the children's commissioner. And in fact, in her submission to the committee, she highlighted some concern about the overlap of her role in supporting the rights and interests of children with that potentially of our victims and witnesses commissioners. So those were the sorts of issues. There were obviously some others, but those I would say were the key issues that were raised.
Okay, Thank you for that very comprehensive answer, Audrey. I mean, of course, the Scottish Government itself is, it says it's committed to the establishment of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner, and they've said that it would fill an identified accountability gap. Did the committee recognise any accountability gap that needed to be filled?
Yes, I mean, as you say, the Scottish Government's position is that there is a gap, if you like, particularly in and around scrutiny of criminal justice bodies. So I suppose to answer your question, there are already a number of bodies that engage in scrutiny, if you like. The inspectors, for example, Inspectorate of Constabulary, Inspectorate of Prosecutions, the PERC. So to a certain extent, there is already a degree of scrutiny in and around criminal justice and how that impacts on victims and witnesses. And of course, I suppose there are other, as I said in my first answer, there are a range of well-established organisations, Victim Support Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid, Rape Crisis Scotland, and potentially even cross-party groups that to one extent or another engage in scrutiny that comes back to, circles back to where we are going in Scotland to improve the experiences of victims and witnesses. And I think, you know, this perhaps all starts from a baseline that everybody recognises that the experience of victims and witnesses in the justice system is very often poor, it's traumatising, and that things do need to change.
Do you think there's enough parliamentary oversight of that landscape, which does seem rather complex, to put it mildly?
I mean, I can only speak in terms of the Criminal Justice Committee, and I suppose what I would say to that is, in the work that we do, which is not scrutiny of a bill, then I would say that a significant aspect of our work, our scrutiny work, ultimately circles back to the experiences of victims and witnesses. So obviously the work that we do in and around violence against women and girls, also at the moment we are considering the police bill, and you could argue that the police bill will bring in improved arrangement, or it's seeking to bring in improved arrangements around the experience of individuals who encounter Police Scotland officers and find themselves in a position where they either have made a complaint about a policing matter or there is a misconduct investigation being carried out. So, you know, you could argue that that ultimately does circle back to the experience of victims and witnesses. So I'd say, you know, there is already a broad range of work, but in the context of the committee, much of our work does land in the space of improving the experience of victims and witnesses.
Okay, thank you. And Claire, you took your committee took a somewhat different view when it came to the patients commissioner. You said, and I quote, that it's important to ensure public confidence and trust in healthcare system in Scotland. So what was it that you felt was lacking that a commissioner could deliver?
So thank you very much, convener, for inviting me along this morning. My apologies that I can't be there in person. I think it's important to note where the idea of a patient safety commissioner came from, and that was from the UK-wide Independent Medicines and Medical Devices Safety Review, more commonly known as the Cumberledge Review, which highlighted or looked at the issues around about mesh, around about sodium valproate and around about primidose particularly, and highlighted that patients didn't feel that they had been listened to and about the length of time that it took for problems to be acknowledged. So from the 9 recommendations from that review, one of those was to appoint a patient safety commissioner to be an independent public leader with a statutory responsibility who'd champion listening to patients and promoting service users' perspectives and seeking improvements to patient safety around the use of medicines and medical devices. So as a direct consequence of that, a patient safety commissioner was appointed for England and Wales in September 2022. So the committee, whilst I wasn't a member of the committee at the time that took evidence, had the advantage of being able to seek guidance and seek information from that commissioner. And the Scottish Government also gave a commitment that it would implement all of those recommendations from the review, including the creation of a patient safety commissioner for Scotland, and that was done via primary legislation. I think it's fair to acknowledge that, you know, there's a complex regulatory landscape already existed around patient safety in Scotland prior to the bill. I suppose some of the issues that Audrey Nicholl has highlighted, the committee also considered. But they felt that the role had the potential to improve patient safety across health services in Scotland, and ultimately then supported the bill, the general principles of the bill at stage one.
I mean, you've almost touched on the next question I was going to kind of ask you, which was a concern that your stage one report said, and I quote, "Stakeholders noted concerns over the potential for overlap and duplication of roles and responsibilities within the system, and the future role of the proposed commissioner within an already complex landscape." So clearly there are issues about where the commissioner would operate, you know, relative to the kind of you know, existing landscape that you're working within. So, what kind of how do you feel that can be? How can the commissioner really work within that effectively without having duplication overlap?
Well, I think, you know, one of the key things is the independence of the role. Having the commissioner having the freedom to define and to establish the principles underpinning their work, the scope and the remit of their work. But also one of the recommendations that the committee made was that patients should be given the opportunity to provide input into the scope and remit of that work, that perhaps is not as evident in other commissioner roles looking at patient safety or in other bodies that look at assessing medical devices and medicines. So I think it was generally accepted by stakeholders that there was a need for this role, and that was certainly reflected in the evidence that the committee got, both written evidence but also in their evidence sessions.
And how do you measure the success, or not as the case may be, of such a commissioner? Because one of the things that this committee is concerned about in a whole host of areas is outcomes.
I think you're absolutely right. We have to make sure that there are positive outcomes come from the creation of any commissioner. And I really welcome this inquiry, given the number of commissioners and proposed commissioners that there are. And there has to be evaluation. The commissioner will lay before Parliament a report on an annual basis. That doesn't preclude them from doing that on other investigations that they carry out or other areas that they investigate. So I think it's really important with all commissioners that we ensure that there is value for money, and that that the roles that they carry out aren't duplicated, that there isn't unnecessary overlap, but also that there's collaboration between commissioners so that the use of resources is used effectively, and that there is that, you know, the... If you have good working relationships across commissioners, then that duplication of work should be reduced.
Okay, thanks. And Audrey, you've said that such a commissioner, you know, victims and witnesses, should be for a time-limited period, and that Parliament would want to see clear evidence that the post of commissioner has noticeably improved the experience in victims and witnesses. So how do you envisage the Parliament be able to scrutinise that effectively?
Yeah, the committee did sort of come to that conclusion as an option in the event that the Scottish Government, you know, is clear that it wishes a commissioner post to be established.
Not keen, but if it does go ahead, you want a sunset clause. Would that be right?
Yeah. And I think we set out in our report that we would, I suppose, one option would be that a piece of work is undertaken to evaluate the effectiveness of the commissioner over the period of its existence. Obviously, that would need to be set against criteria, issues that the Parliament considers are appropriate to measure in terms of what is it that we're actually looking for the Commissioner to undertake and to achieve, and then measure that the success of that work.
Okay, and I note that the Biometrics Commissioner really falls within kind of your remit. In terms of scrutinising that individual and the work of his team, he gave evidence. I thought his evidence was really interesting when he came to committee. I was very impressed by the kind of work that's being done. But would the committee consider, for example, not just taking evidence round table as we do today, but actually going out to visit the Biometrics Commissioner and look at what they're doing on the ground? Is that something you feel might be beneficial in, for example, assessing the work of a specific commissioner, such as, for example, biometrics?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, as you say, and I watched with interest the biometrics commissioner, Dr. Plasto, giving evidence to committee 2 or 3 weeks ago. And as he described it, the work that he's doing is quite niche, and it's certainly of great interest to everybody. And I would wholeheartedly support an option such as going out to visit the commissioner, because as you know, sometimes it can be difficult to bring commissioners or other witnesses into committee just because of a tight work programme. And you'll know the Criminal Justice Committee has a significant workload in and around bills, so I would wholeheartedly support that suggestion.
Just one question to you, Claire, before opening out the session to colleagues around the table, and that's just that we had our own round table last week, and one of the issues was the fact that it came up was that potentially commissioners could take away some of the kind of democratic accountability of ministers. I'm just wondering where you feel the kind of patients commissioner fits in with ministerial responsibility.
I wasn't on the committee at the time, I find that a really difficult question to answer in terms of the evidence that the committee took round about that. As I said, the commissioner will have to lay before Parliament an annual report, so Parliament will have the opportunity to scrutinise that, and committees will have the opportunity to have the Patient Safety Commissioner invited in to take evidence sessions from them, as they would with all other commissioners.
Okay, thank you. So the first colleague to ask questions will be Liz, to be followed by Michael.
Thank you and good morning. One of the issues that's been put to us by people who've given evidence so far at the committee is that one of the reasons for the proposals to increase the number of commissioners is because there have been failures in public services, which has resulted in a new demand. And Ms Hawkey, I'm sure, will be aware of the El Jamel case, where I would cite ongoing examples of where the public health services have failed the former patients of El Jamel, and I'm sure the forthcoming public inquiry will uncover some of that. And Ms Nicol, in terms of the police bill, some would argue that that's because of pressures on the existing police forces, that they're not able to do some of the things that you would like them to be able to do. To what extent do you feel that these people who've given evidence to our committee so far have a fair point about failure in public service?
So, I mean, in terms of the, you mentioned the police bill, if we can start with that bill. So already we've taken evidence that would suggest significant failures in the, not just the sort of conduct of police officers and others, but the way in which those issues around or those acts of misconduct, alleged misconduct, have been dealt with internally, and I think there, you know, there are a lot of sort of reasons that seem to be emerging as to why that may be happening, with specific regard to Police Scotland. But I think in answer to your question, I mean, and again, citing the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner proposal. Part of that has been based on what feels like a failure to date to grasp the nettle and respond to concerns, respond to perceived failings in the conduct of organisations. So I think it's a very understandable, perhaps, public interest that, you know, bodies are held to account, and if that requires a legislative change or indeed the creation or establishment of a commissioner that can represent them, then I understand that sentiment.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I think Liz Smith raises a really pertinent and interesting point there, specifically about the Dr. El-Jamal and the concerns that were raised there. I think if you look back at the origins of the Patient Safety Commissioner and the Cumberledge Review, as I said, there's three main issues that were looked at about mesh, about sodium valproate, about primidose. Those were issues that were being raised by patients, predominantly women, and almost exclusively women, in terms of the effects that those medical devices and those medications were having on them and their children. And so, you know, we need to ensure there's a mechanism for those issues to be raised and to be investigated. And that was why it was felt that the Patient Safety Commissioner would be able to be the vehicle for doing that, to be able to look at broader systems issues, issues with medication devices, and to raise those issues in a way that perhaps individual patient voices weren't being listened to, because that was what the committee had heard, and certainly that's what the Cumberledge Review had heard.
I think that's a very interesting reflection. I mean, there is possibly an issue that it is human error in some cases, where the people who have been responsible for overseeing a case have not done their job effectively. But potentially there is system failure as well. And I think in some ways that's the more interesting point, because that's the one that might need legislative changes. And I just wonder what your reflections are about whether we should be spending more time on trying to address failure within the existing public services, or whether we should move to further commissioners.
I can come in on that. I mean, I think, again, going back to our scrutiny, which is just underway, of the police bill, and last week, in fact, we took evidence and we looked at the issues around training in Police Scotland. So obviously we can cast our minds back to 10 years ago, I think it was, when 8 police forces became a single force. And one of the issues that we looked at there was the potential for that process of amalgamation to have involved, to a certain extent, some cost-cutting and fine-tuning of service delivery, and that areas that were potentially seen as non-essential, if you like, in operational delivery were changed. And one of the issues that we looked at was around police training, and also leadership. Having worked in that world, I declare, obviously, I'm a former police officer, there's perhaps a perception that things like equality and diversity training are desirable, but not necessarily essential. However, is there potentially a legacy now where several years on we are looking at a situation where issues around misconduct by police officers seems to be something that is catching the public eye, if you like, and obviously we're now at the point where we're looking at the bill on the back of Lady Dame Eilish Angelini's extensive review of the handling of police misconduct and complaints.
Thank you, Ms Hawkey. You were very, I thought, sensible in responding to the convener's issue about this sort of democratic accountability line, because that's really what we're after as a committee, that as well as examining the cost, which is obviously our meat and drink in this committee, but the actual accountability line is very important, because it seems to me, and certainly I've got far more experience on the health side of things because of the Elgemel case, it seems to me that there was so much buck passing and it was always somebody else's problem, and that left so many of these distressed patients at their wit's end about all the traumas that they'd faced. And therefore, I think if we're going to ensure that there are better public services, we have to make a decision about how best to get accountability into the system. I would just be interested in your views how that would take place within the health brief.
So I thank Liz Smith for that answer. I think there is certainly the opportunity for the Patient Safety Commissioner to do that. One of the things that struck me from reading through the evidence was how stakeholders and professional organisations and professional regulators and as well as individuals described how they saw the potential for the Commissioner to be a golden thread that sort of unifies and unites patient safety and clinical governance structures, because, you know, there are numerous clinical governance structures, there's numerous oversight organisations, professional regulators and so on. It struck me as if this is what the patient group and patient representatives feel is going to help their voice be amplified, then the Patient Safety Commissioner is indeed a worthwhile commissioner to have. There has to be review, there has to be accountability. Absolutely, we're talking about public money here, and we want this to succeed in terms of allowing those particularly less heard voices to be heard, and for all healthcare providers to be accountable for their practice and for the care that they deliver, and for issues particularly around about medicine and medication devices to be highlighted at the earliest opportunity, which is not something that the Cumberledge Review reflected.
Okay, thank you both.
Thank you. Michael, followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. I want to follow up a little bit on this. You'll be aware that there's a request for a large number of new conveners, and that's part of the concern of the committee. But the two, I think, that both of your committees are most particularly involved in of late, the Victims and Witness Commissioner and the Patient Safety Commissioner, would maybe reflect on some of the broader demands for that. We've had a variety of evidence on this, and I wonder whether I could ask you to reflect as to whether these are questions of the moment, or are they more systemic? So are they happening now because of austerity, lack of resource, governance issues, or are these part of an architecture that you think is addressing more permanent systemic issues? Maybe start with Audrey Nicol.
Thanks for that question. Again, in terms of the work of the Criminal Justice Committee and our sort of interaction with a range of issues that come back to the experience of victims and witnesses, I think what came out in our evidence when we were scrutinising the proposals around the Victims Commissioner was just the sort of historical challenge that is experienced by victims in particular when they enter the criminal justice system. So I think in answer to your question, I would say that probably you're looking at a more systemic challenge. However, I would also possibly propose the possibility that has been, you know, that has been enhanced, if you like, by where we are in the moment. So that experience of poverty, poor mental health, the pressures on families arising from where we are in the sort of economic space. So perhaps it's a bit of a hybrid of both from my perspective.
Thank you, Audrey. Claire Hawkey, same question.
Thanks. I think I come at this from a slightly different angle, given the origins of the Patient Safety Commission commissioner proposal. Given that we're looking at issues that were raised, which were from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and up to the 2000s. So I think it's a different landscape that we're looking at that has put in the foundations for the need for a patient safety commissioner. And consistently, in written and oral evidence, it was about patients' voices not being heard. It was about perhaps feeling that they weren't being believed. It's about advocating for those voices, raising concerns about issues related to medication, medication side effects, medication devices, etc. Although the Patient Safety Commissioner of Scotland has a wider remit than the one in England and Wales. Okay. So there will be some of that plays into this in terms of deprivation and in terms of austerity, but I think this has a much deeper history.
Thank you for that. I suppose then, drawing on what the convener was saying about outcomes and whether these commissioners will actually have the ability to make change, can maybe look at the Criminal Justice Committee's work on this. How would you see the Victims Commissioner actually then affecting outcomes for citizens? Like can you describe your kind of theory of change that makes something better for people?
So I think what...
Sorry, I also recognise within that you've been sceptical about the proposal, but
Thanks for that question. I mean, it's a difficult question to answer. You know, I can have my own views on that. And it's perhaps not necessarily something that the committee collectively discussed. But I think one of the things perhaps to think about in that is the proposal for the commissioner. One of the things that sat underneath that was that it gave victims and witnesses a voice that perhaps they don't have at the moment. And I think that... can't remember if it's in the bill or in a submission, but that a key point was engagement with victims and witnesses by the commissioner. So that was seen as a key role of the commissioner in their work to, I suppose, scrutinise policy, scrutinise legislation, and the work of stakeholders, if you like. So that might be that's certainly one area of focus, perhaps, that could be considered in terms of scrutinising the effectiveness of just what that looks like, what form does it take, and what is the value of that.
On the 17th of January, the new First Minister, who was a member of the committee, I believe, at the time, said the commissioner essentially wouldn't have any teeth. He said, the bill says the role of the commissioner is to monitor compliance, this is a quote, with standards, promote best practice in relation to trauma-informed practice and undertaking commission research. The commissioner will not, under the existing proposal, have the power to put his or her foot down and say, this is not acceptable. That power is somewhere else. So really an expression of concern that as much as these things might be said by a commissioner, it doesn't really necessarily affect change. Mm-hmm. Is that not the First Minister's concern?
Yeah, thanks for that. I think that was articulated not just by the now First Minister. I think that was articulated by other witnesses who really did question the extent to which the commissioner role would influence change, would require, was able to require change. So I think in answer to that, that was probably something that we heard fairly broadly across our evidence taking on the commissioner.
And so that person would then perhaps produce a report that would come to your committee for consideration in the structure of the parliament. Would that be right?
Well, I think, again, reflecting back to the bill and possibly the government's response, I think the proposal was that any review of the effectiveness of the commissioner role would come back to Parliament.
Yeah. I suppose I'm more in terms of their day-to-day work, because I suppose there's concerns within the committee as well about the capacity of other committees mm-hmm. to deal with the workload of the outputs of commissioners. Mm-hmm. So the evidence that we had on the 30th of April from Brian Plastow, who's accountable to your own mm-hmm. committee, he said, I've been in post for 3 years, I've been called before the committee once in 3 years, and that was to discuss the passing of the statute code of practice back in 2022. In those 3 years, I have submitted 7 reports mm-hmm. to Parliament, 2 annual reports and accounts, 1 operational report, code of practice, 3 separate assurance reviews. My expectation would have been to have been called before the Criminal Justice Committee more often than I have been. Mm-hmm. I believe he's to come in November, but once. Yeah. But does this not talk to a structural issue about, because I recognise that your committee is incredibly busy with legislation, not just this legislation, but lots of others. Do you not have the capacity to actually work with these commissioners to ensure that the good work that they're doing is processed effectively?
Thanks for that. And I think it's a really important point to raise. You know, I'm very aware that Dr. Plastow made some commentary around his engagement with the committee, and I think it does, you know, without making excuses at all, I think it does go to the capacity of our committee. As you acknowledge, we are legislation heavy. We will be having the commissioner in later on, and I do follow, because of the real public interest in the work he's doing, I certainly regularly follow the work that he's doing, and I'm aware of the compliance reports that he has submitted. So would I like that to be a different situation? Absolutely. But the challenges of our workload make it difficult, and I think that's that just reflects where we are in terms of parliamentary work. I think just one other point I would make, just on that, in terms of the potential sort of follow-up scrutiny undertaken by the Criminal Justice Committee in and around the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner role, I wonder if there's also perhaps a case that there may be a role for other committees to scrutinise the work of that particular commissioner, given, the cross-cutting, overlapping issues that potentially that commissioner may be engaged in looking at.
Claire Hawkey, on the outputs of the Cumberledge review, it's my understanding that was, I suppose, a reasonably technical request in terms of medical devices and medical interventions to provide oversight around those technical issues that perhaps Parliament does not more broadly have the specialist knowledge to understand and to examine. So it requires a specialist capacity to do it. But I think your committee is, you're talking more about advocacy not being heard and not being believed. So more about voice rather than that technical capacity. To be devil's advocate on this, are those not things that parliamentarians should be doing, listening to citizens, advocating on their behalf? Do we need somebody else to do that?
I wouldn't disagree with you, Mr. Mara, that is absolutely our role as elected representatives, and I'm sure that you have been representing your constituents in issues relating to what they perceive as medical negligence or issues accessing healthcare or just concerns about the impact that some medication or medication devices have had on them. I think the landscape of patient safety is complex. We have, clinical governance structures. We have royal colleges that look at issues. We have UK-wide oversight of some medications and issues relating to those. I think it's really important that we ensure that the public is confident and has trust in the healthcare system. And having a clear purpose to advocate for system-wide improvements in the safety of healthcare and promoting the importance of the views of patients and members of the public, I think is an absolute key role for that commissioner. I referred earlier to what stakeholders described as that golden thread to bring together all of those systems and structures. Obviously, we don't yet have a patient safety commissioner in that role yet, but that would be what the committee anticipated would be the outcomes for having a patient safety commissioner. And obviously, ultimately, Parliament passed that legislation, and so parliamentarians agreed that that was a commissioner that was required.
Okay. My final question relates to finance. In the you acknowledged, I think, in your report, our concerns, our committee's concerns in our letter of 31st January regarding the parliamentary resource that draws on from the funds from the SPCB, but you simply noted, I think, that sufficient resources to the SPCB to support the work of the Commissioner should be handed down by the Government. Have you had any assurances from the Government that they'll actually do that?
I don't think there's been any further correspondence with the committee, but I'm certainly happy to check with clerks and update Mr Mara and the rest of the committee on that issue.
Okay. Thank you, Camille.
Thank you. So it's John to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, convener. Maybe I can just follow on from what Michael Mara was asking towards yourself, Ms Hockey, to start with at least. I mean, you've said various things, and you specifically said system-wide, and then you said because of the history of the problems through the 60s and so on, that's specifically why there's a need for the patient safety commissioner. So, I mean, I'm asking you to speculate a bit, but do you think your committee would take a different view if a commissioner was proposed for, something specific like, say, MS or arthritis? Because some of the arguments are that, well, their voice isn't being heard either, so their voice would be heard more if there was a commissioner for different kinds of disability, and that is actually one that's proposed, and so on and so forth. So I suppose I'm asking, was this a kind of unique situation because of the circumstances?
I think given the UK-wide review and the acceptance from Scottish Government, and obviously I can't speak for Scottish Government, but their acceptance of all of the recommendations, creating the post for Patient Safety Commissioner certainly made sense given the history and the outcome of that report. I understand that there's an argument for commissioners for various other issues, and I'm sure there'll be many more proposals will come forward to Parliament. I suppose, and I say this rather than from a committee point of view, from a personal point of view, that we need to ensure that that there is that there's good sound rationale for that, and that it's going to add value to the public landscape and to public conversation and to advocacy for those individual groups. And I suppose that's why the committee is looking into this particular issue. I would say that, and certainly in terms of the Patient Safety Commissioner, that evidence was there of why we required to appoint one.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. I mean, one of our predecessor committees, the Finance Committee, I think in 2006, had suggested that there should be a limit on how many more commissioners we had. And they suggested, we should look at alternate models. And I just wonder if your committee, in this case, if you did look at alternate models, as to how else, either, for example, could an existing commissioner have taken this on, And one that some witnesses have said to us is that we should expand the role of the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and then they could have like a department or a rapporteur who would look after, say, patient safety, say, children's affairs, say, older people, you know, that kind of model. Is that something your committee considered at all?
I think the committee considered the evidence that was put in front of them and the overwhelming evidence from stakeholder and stakeholder groups was that they supported this. You know, in terms of exploration of other models, I can certainly again write to this committee if that was explored in any wider fashion. As I said at the beginning, I wasn't convener of the committee at the time that they took evidence. I certainly wasn't privy then to any of the private discussions. It's only this public papers and the report on recommending that the commissioner be, or the general principles of that bill be approved.
Okay, thanks. That was maybe an unfair question on my part, so I'll ask Audrey Nicol as well. Alternate models, because you within your remit, I think there are quite a lot of alternate models, because you've already mentioned the Inspector of Constabulary, I think, and the Inspector of Prisons. Now, they're both not funded by Parliament, but funded by the government, and yet I think they're quite independent, so I'd be interested to know, is that another model that works?
Yes, thank you. I mean, yes, you're right that there are a number of inspectors that sit within the criminal justice space, as you've mentioned. I suppose that my, and again, speaking personally, my instinct is that they do work independently, having read quite a number of, for example, reports of the HMICS, the position that they take on an issue, whatever that might be, feels quite independent and quite probing to me. And some of these, the reports that I've certainly seen published by the HMICS, for example, have been quite challenging. And there is an expectation with them, of course, that recommendations that are made by the HMICS, as one example, are actioned. So I think, you know, that is a model that does appear to do what it says on the tin. I mean, another example, perhaps, is a recent report by the HMI for prosecutions in and around the way in which cases of domestic abuse are being processed through our court system. And there's certainly some good practice, but there were areas that were highlighted as requiring attention, if you like. Now, I know that the commentary around that I'm confident that it will be scrutinised and recommendations made around that will certainly be considered in terms of how they can be implemented. So, I think as I highlighted in one of my early responses, certainly the criminal justice space, you've got inspectorates, but you've also got third sector organisations that really work tirelessly and do some really valuable work ultimately to make the experience of victims and witnesses better. So perhaps there is and maybe it is right that we have a broad range of scrutiny processes, if you like, which some of which are fulfilled by third sector, some of which are accountable to the Parliament. Perhaps, you know, that's a model that we should welcome in Scotland.
Despite the good work that the third sector is doing in a lot of areas, is that they don't have the power to really make, well, I mean, the phrase binding recommendations has been made a number of times, which would really be quite strong if they could actually dictate, although you've just suggested, I can't remember which body it was, makes recommendations which almost always are accepted.
Yeah, I mean, just on that point, and it's a very valid point to make. However, I would cite a recent example where a third sector body, the Rape Crisis Scotland, so we have been engaging, the committee has engaged with Rape Crisis Scotland on the issue of accessing court transcripts by victims of sexual offences where a trial took place and where a victim potentially feels that accessing a transcript of that process will support closure, coming to terms with what happened, perhaps. However, at the moment, it is extremely costly to purchase, if you like, a court or access a court transcript from the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. So we've done a piece of work with Rape Crisis Scotland, and I'm really pleased to say that the Scottish Government has now put in place a pilot where, in certain circumstances, a transcript will be made available at no cost. So that's perhaps one example yes. of where there can be a little bit of power to the elbow of organisations.
The third sector and the committee are working closely together. Yes, no, that's a very good example. I mean, I don't know how much your committee is involved with the Scottish Human Rights Commission, because I think they've suggested if they were given a bit more power, like to initiate inquiries, and then they could kind of coordinate this whole field of human rights a bit more, because a lot of this we're talking about is human rights related. Is that a model you think is worth looking at?
I would be happy that is explored. I think perhaps we are at a point that we maybe do need to look at models that promote best practice. It may not be that, and I suspect it is not the case, that there is a one-size-fits-all. I'm not familiar with the position of the Human Rights Commission in Scotland, but I would welcome and I would expect that would be perhaps part of your committee's scrutiny of this.
Okay. Right, I think I'll leave it at that. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, John. Michelle.
Good morning, both of you. You've actually given a very good example, Audrey, which kind of illustrates my question. I was just looking at the new Minister and Cabinet Secretary's responsibilities, and I was noticing Ivan McKee's includes public service reform, efficient government, and so on. So I've always got a hypothetical question for you both, that if a stringent new cap on public sector expenditure was brought into force, that meant that the commissioner that you were required to consider as part of your recent scrutiny was removed, what specifically would you do, or do you already have the answers to that, to address some of the issues around victims and witnesses' treatment? And for yourself, Claire, as well, obviously, given that it's a slightly different situation, if that was removed, I'm not saying that it's going to be, I don't want to set any hairs running, I'm just saying it as a hypothetical situation. What actions would you be able to take to address the perceived gap? So, Audrey, perhaps you could go first.
That's a big question in the criminal justice space. I mean, I think thinking back to, if I can go into committee mode for a moment, thinking back to the evidence that we took across the bill, and as you know, that the bill is about improving the experience of victims and witnesses, which at the moment is just not good enough. The challenge with that is within criminal justice there are bodies, separate bodies, and this did come up in evidence, is to affect positive change across that whole system is extremely difficult. Take, for example, proposals around trauma-informed practice. Lots of good work going on just now. We know that agencies are embedding that, but we're still not there yet. So I suppose my question back to you would be, how across separate agencies do you affect a whole system approach? There are ways that you can do that don't cost money. to the extent of perhaps creating new legislation or creating a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. And I would think, so an example of that might be post-legislative scrutiny. So looking at, can that process within the Parliament, can that be affected more more frequently, more effectively, then that may be an option. In terms of the public purse, I mean, we know that hard choices are having to be made. But again, I suppose it comes back to, if you look at enhancing the provision in one area, where are you taking that from? And in the space, and in the criminal justice space, that is incredibly difficult. So I'm not sure I've really given you a concrete answer, because it's such a huge question, but those are maybe a couple of points that come to my mind, and I think certainly the committee would agree with.
I mean, in some respects, you have answered my question, because if you had sat and said, we have no idea how we could improve things without the installation of a commissioner, then that arguably would have answered it. But actually, you've already got quite a lot of ideas in your original example you gave about Ellie Wilson promoting the transcripts of rape victims was another earlier version. Claire, I'll come to you. So I've got my cutting knife in the name of Mr. Ivan McKee. Realistically, what are the remedies, And how readily do they come to mind, that if the patient safety commissioner was to be no more?
I think to answer what is a very difficult and complex question, we need to look at what has got us to this point, what the historical issues were, that those less represented voices were not heard, that the women who were raising issues around about the medications and the medical devices, such as mesh, we're not being listened to, we're not being heard, we're being dismissed. So I would sort of turn that round to, so if we're not going to have a patient safety commissioner, how do we ensure that those patient voices are heard, that those concerns are responded to in a timely way, that they're believed? Because what is the cost, not only financial, but emotional and physical cost, for not listening early to those people who are saying there's issues here and we need to change how things are prescribed or how treatments are actioned?
Thank you for that. And that, does that then not play to Liz Smith's earlier comment about systemic issues and organisational cultural issues where people's voices are not being heard? And is that another remedy in terms of doing the work, which is very difficult, I know from experience, previous experience, to change culture and organisations, but is that a potential remedy?
I think that certainly ensuring that the complex landscape that we have for patient safety is pulled together, that all of that the public has trust and confidence in the healthcare that's being provided, and that they are being listened to, and that those concerns are being responded to, is absolutely key. However, what the committee heard from its written and oral evidence and in the previous report was that that wasn't the case. So that's something that does have to be remedied. And having a commissioner in place to pull that all together is one remedy for that.
OK, thank you. And I've just got a wee kind of follow-on question for yourself, Ms. Nicol, in terms of the recommendation of your committee to consider a time-limited period should it be gone ahead with a commissioner. And I just wondered, did you give any consideration to what that might be, given the set-up costs, which are considerable, the set-up and the establishment, organisational establishment costs? Did you think about what time period might be?
Yeah, thanks for that. Yes, you're right. We did, as you say, make a suggestion that should the government be minded to establish a commissioner post, then perhaps one option, given the current landscape that we're in, would be to establish it in a time-limited basis, but with a review to a piece of work being done to evaluate and to sort of scrutinise the effectiveness. We didn't particularly consider a time. I think that would be perhaps something that would be refined further on into the further stages of the bill, once there was perhaps some consideration of what would be an optimum time. Mm. So enough time for the work of the commissioner to embed, so that there were clear outcomes and that there was value in the role being established. But as you quite rightly say, you know, there is the financial aspect to that as well.
And were you simply being kind to the government rather than saying, no, we don't think we should have one? Were you kind of thinking, maybe we'll be nice and suggest an interim measure? I know I'm being slightly controversial, but were you being kind and coming up with another option, or was it really a sensible suggestion?
I think where we were coming from was on the basis of the evidence that we heard. So there was a lot of support for the proposals around a victims and witnesses commissioner, particularly from some organisations actually already working with victims, less so with witnesses. So I think we were trying to reflect the reality of the situation that we're in from a financial perspective, but also recognise the support that exists for the post of commissioner. And again, it comes back to the fact that there is an absolute acknowledgement across individual sectors, Parliament, government, that things do need to change.
Mm-hmm. And my last wee question, it's just a sentence for you both. You've probably got a sense from the committee that of all the people we've spoken to, and I would like to believe that we're conducting a very thorough investigation so far, everybody appears in front of us with a good grasp of their particular individual mm-hmm. area, and correctly sets out and articulates convincingly why they think a commissioner is necessary or indeed effective. But from our point of view, we're looking at the entire landscape mm-hmm. rather than one individual silo, and that's perhaps where the mismatch comes in. So again, a slight hypothetical question for you both just to finish off is, if you were us and you were required to look at the entire landscape from both an efficiency and effective government and critical financial constraints, what would your reflections be? Audrey, you smiled. You can go first.
I think it would be a timeous and worthwhile piece of work. It's been quite an enjoyable preparation period for me to come to committee today and really look at the landscape around commissioners and just the... And I think it did come out in some of the evidence that you took was just the kind of, not pick and mix, but that there are a number of models. There's the emerging landscape of commissioners has happened, I think it was called organically, mm-hmm. And so perhaps in the spirit of efficiency, transparency, we are at a point that a fairly robust overarching review is entirely appropriate.
Thank you. Claire?
I would agree with what Audrey says there. When I welcome the committee's inquiry into this. When I saw this was something that you were looking at, I thought it was certainly very timely and a very worthwhile exercise. I suppose my only thing to add to that would be to really scrutinise what it is that organisations, stakeholders, the general public think that a commissioner is going to do that will improve or advocate more for their particular cause, issue, concern. So that would be my sort of challenge to the committee. But we, you know, I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Jamie.
Thanks very much. Actually, it was really kind of on that point, Claire. It's just a quick question. If I can come to you first, and then maybe to Audrey. We've talked about stakeholders a lot, and you can appreciate why stakeholders and organisations may be very supportive of commissioners, but that general public approach and kind of appreciation, I was just wondering, Claire, what you felt, and if whether there's any evidence of the public's perception of commissioners, what they do and how effective they are, and also how important you felt that public awareness of the role of commissioners and their responsibilities is in their success or otherwise.
I think that's a really interesting question, and I would hope that perhaps your committee would look at some of those issues about what the perception are and how well recognised commissioners are by the general public and what they do, the role that they carry out. I imagine from my own casework that the SPSO is probably the highest profile of those organisations. And but I'm sure there are commissioners whose profile is not as high as perhaps some stakeholder organisations might hope that they would be. One of the things, or one of the things about the Patient Safety Commissioner was that the committee would wish or wished them to make sure that there was public information went out about what their role was, to clarify what the role was, that they wouldn't take on individual complaints, but that they would then make the general public more aware of their role. And I think that's probably something that other commissions could perhaps, or commissioners could perhaps look at.
I suppose this is a question because of the better known a commissioner is, and this is why outcomes are so important, because you also have to see the outcomes at the end, but the better known they might be, more work they may have to do, the higher their budgets mm-hmm. might need to be, so they almost could be kind of victims, to use a phrase, of their own success. But of course that could mean there could be cost outcomes. I was wondering, Audrey, if you could give us some thoughts.
Thanks for the question. I would agree with probably everything that Claire Hawhey has set out. I think that there will be, as you say, there will be greater public awareness of some commissioner roles, Human Rights Commission, perhaps the Children's Commissioner, probably less so in and around commissioners such as the Biometrics Commissioner. You know, why would you? Having said that, the work that he's undertaking is highly relevant to where we are going in and around biometrics. So I concur with Claire Hawhey's comments that's probably in terms of general awareness of access to commissioners and their role and their purpose and responsibilities, then that's perhaps a piece of work that this committee will be considering, I'm sure it is, in your work around scrutinising the landscape.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, and that's concluded questions from the committee. I'm just wondering if our witnesses have any final points they wish to make, if they feel we've omitted anything, or if they've got any burning desire to add anything to your deliberations.
Just thanks again for the opportunity to come and meet with committee today. Thank you.
Okay, Claire?
Can I just put on record my register of interest in that I hold an NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde Bank staff nurse contract, just in case I've strayed into any issues this morning that might raise that as a concern. But apart from that, thank you very much for the opportunity.
Well, thank you both very much for your welcome contributions, and also I hope you're feeling a little better soon, Claire. See you back here at the ranch. So without further ado, I'm going to call a 5-minute break in order for our witnesses to leave and other witnesses to settle in. Thank you. Where are we? Please meet you. Come back, everyone. We continue taking evidence in relation to our inquiry into Scotland's Commissioner Landscape. I therefore welcome to the meeting Sue Webber, Convener of the Education, Children and Young People Committee, and Martin Whitfield, Convener of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I'm going to open up the session now to questions from members, given that there are no opening statements. I think the first thing I'd probably like to ask, basically, is how the committee scrutinise the performance of these of the commissioners within their remit.
Okay. Well, you may be aware that we've just had a new commissioner come into post in terms of the Young People's Commissioner. So we've actually been had her in front of us very recently. And I think we've been quite thoughtful about how best to carry out the scrutiny role given her new position. We also have to recognise that each commissioner's quite different. And in my role as convener, I was never given the opportunity to scrutinise the previous convener. I've only ever had Nicola in front of us, I suppose. And we heard evidence from her and her team about their strategic plan. So that's going to set the tone of what we're going to be looking for from her for the next year or so. So we were always looking to see what her priorities were going to be, and we were glad to know those were around poverty, education, mental health, climate change and discrimination. So there's nothing unfamiliar, I suppose, or nothing as a surprise. And they are all in the work plan that the Commissioner is keen to focus on. But we're also really interested. She spoke at length about what she called an accountability tracker. And that's designed to hold the government and also other bodies to account in how they're progressing some of their plans in around the landscape that she's working in and the promises they've made to children and young people. So we'll be keen to see how that develops and gives us some sort of oversight and as a tool to track progress. I don't know how long I could talk for a while, Mr.
Talk
Gibson.
For as long as you like.
Okay. and it was also interesting to learn about how she was looking at doing and carrying out new and innovative ways to engage with the young people to make sure it was the young people's voices. I know I'm fortunate enough here to have a couple of members on this committee that were part of that evidence, so I know they'll reinforce that. But we've also, the Commissioner's powers are being expanded later on this year in terms of the incorporation of the UNCRC. So again, that's going to be something that we will be able to sort of gauge how our powers are having some influence across the community. But other than that, our scrutiny is going to be based mainly on the evidence the Commissioner's Office shares with us, aligned to our other programmes of work, which are around legislation and evidence on bills and inquiries that we are working on. So that's where we are.
So the Commissioner gives you a lot of evidence and the committee asks a lot of questions, etc. But how do you evaluate how effective that Commissioner is? I mean, how do you, just take it, at face value, or are there other ways in which you actually examine the Commissioner to see whether or not the Commissioner is actually, delivering what they are supposed to do in terms of their remit? And how do you assess that in relation to the budget that they have and whether they're delivering their budget efficiently and effectively?
I suppose what's difficult, I suppose, is everything that the Commissioner generally does is more subjective, which is why we were so keen to learn about that accountability tracker. And in terms of the budgets, I think you'll know there's that split in roles and responsibilities in terms of challenging her budget. I suppose we're, as a committee, I suspect, just taking assurances that the role in terms of her coming in with her balanced budget is being scrutinised adequately elsewhere within the parliamentary process. I think that's the corporate body. Apologies if I've got that wrong. But again, yes, the KPIs that you hear about in so many ways when we're challenging perhaps government ministers aren't quite as relevant to, I would suggest, the officer of the Children's Commissioner role. I think we have to be a bit more subjective in how we do that.
OK, Martin.
Thank you, and thank you to the committee for the opportunity to talk about such crucial roles within Scottish society. I think one of the interesting aspects of the committee that I have the pleasure of convening with regard to our commissioners are they are the oldest commissioners in Scotland. They were established by legislation at the outset of this Parliament, and they fulfil a slightly different or distinctly different role to some of the other commissioners, because in essence they form a quasi-judicial position. The other advantage that my committee has is that the commissioners' remits are very tightly drawn and sit with my committee rather than crossing a number of committees. And I think one of the challenges, looking from the outside, that I merely comment on rather than go into in depth, is that one of the challenges that I think some of the other commissioners have is that they answer to a number of different bodies. However, within the commissioners that answer to my committee, which is obviously the Scottish Information Commissioner and the Ethical Standards Commissioner, the Scottish Information Commissioner is perhaps an easier one to understand. We get an annual report that basically shows the work in, the work out, and we are able to scrutinise over a period of time how successful that has been. I think, as with, you know, so many institutions across Scotland, COVID threw up real challenges. It threw up challenges in the number of applications for freedom of information, and also the response that the commissioner was able to do. So as to how do we monitor it, although we don't have a direct input with regard to the budget, which obviously sits elsewhere, we are able to interrogate what the blockages are that have led to delays and to investigate those. And if I just pause that at one moment, let me speak about the other commission, then I'll come back to it, because I think in that blockage is an interesting area. The Ethical Standards Commission obviously reports to us in a number of different ways, because the commissioner has a number of different roles. One is with regard to complaints that are made with regard to MSPs, where we sit as part of a process in that. Again, it was set up back in, you know, the Act was 2002, the Standards Commission. And again, for the purposes of an annual report, we get complaints in, complaints out, time taken, process. We talk about where the blockages occurred. And again, COVID caused problems. There was also, in the previous session, a very distinct series of complaints against a member at the time, which caused huge problems simply because of the volume of complaints and the complexity as to the information that was available. This meant that the then commissioner and the current commissioner, who was an acting commissioner towards the end of that period, spent a lot of time scrutinising exactly what the legislation allowed them to do. And I think that it was an unfortunate circumstance that led to it, but was a very profitable exercise. It led to a request being made to those that budget the commissioner for additional funds with explanations of why it was needed. And I think that analysis was incredibly worthwhile doing, because in discussions in the annual reports and when the commissioner comes before us, there is a very clear understanding of where challenges occur. The other part that the Ethical Standards Commissioner deals with in part is in relation to councillors, which doesn't come to my committee. It's a separate thing, but does take up some of the work. And then get to that bit about the blockages. I think there is a challenge in the relationship between the Parliament, the commissioners, and the corporate body and the commissioners. And it is sometimes very difficult to identify who takes responsibility for certain aspects of it. The example that I would give is if a whistleblower exists within a commissioner's wider department, there are very set sort of guidelines about how that can be dealt with. However, before you get to a whistleblowing, where there is a discomfort in the culture, where there is a challenge in the culture, how that is managed and how that is dealt with, I think there are real challenges as to who takes responsibility, be it the Parliament, be it the corporate body, or indeed be it the independent commissioner, because the other thing that we have to remember that underpins all of this is that the commissioners are independent of government, independent but accountable to Parliament, and that there is something that is worth exploring in that field. So with regard to employment conflicts or, you know, the sort of mundane things that happen within organisations that, if they're not dealt with, do become more intrinsic problems, it's very difficult to see how those within commissioners' departments can share that with either the Parliament, who they're accountable to, or indeed corporate bodies. So there are challenges. I think there are benefits to look at the two commissioners that answer to my committee simply because of the time they've been in existence. So they've been around the circle a few times. But there's also the importance of remembering that they fulfil very distinct, as I say, quasi-judicial roles in assessing freedom of information complaints, in assessing complaints against elected officials, in overseeing the public appointments. So they're different but the same, but I do think that environmental challenge about how you can signpost concerns early on probably applies to all commissioners. I'll leave it at that.
I mean, I think we're very well aware of the issues that developed there, but I mean, I know what you're talking about, for example, a vacuum of accountability, which is something you said that should be explored, but where's your instinct about where ultimately responsibility for that should lie? Parliament, government, or commissioner?
That's a relatively easy one, because at the end of the day, a number of commissioners fulfil a role of being critical friend of government. They are independent but accountable to Parliament, because at the end of the day, commissioners are accountable to the people of Scotland, and I think Parliament, it would be worthy of Parliament to take on that responsibility. I think the vehicles that we have within Parliament make that very challenging to do at the moment, and I'm, you know, not going to sit here and say the magic solution is this, because I don't know what it is. There is a challenge between time availability for committees to do the, you know, the analysis. Even just looking at the annual reports can be a problem. But I think that Parliament should take on board the responsibility for ensuring that there is a solution to this.
Yeah, I mean, Ethical Standards Commissioner, I mean, because of the difficulties there and the increase in kind of budget that kind of alerted us probably, was the first thing that alerted us to the significant year-on-year increase in the kind of commissioner costs. I mean, it's around about between 8 and 10% each year over the last couple of years, and that's having an increasingly bigger impact on the Scottish Parliament's budget. How do you feel the Parliament can best deal with that kind of seemingly exponential growth? Because one of the things in budget costs, because if we think about it, you know, the cash increase in the Scottish budget this year was 2.6%, but we're looking at commissioners going up by, you know, 10% or more in some circumstances. So do you feel that that's something we should continue to have a kind of annual kind of review of? Is it something we should cap? How do we address that issue, given the fact that there are so many other commissioners in the pipeline? I'll come to you afterwards.
I think you need to first of all take a step back and talk about the transparency of funding in relation to, you know, what the Parliament is responsible for. Because I think if you speak to most people and you talked about the Scottish Parliament's budget, most people would basically say it's this place and the people and the support that sort of sit around this table, when in reality it's far wider than that, and I'm not sure that there is a genuine understanding of the importance of where that funding goes. But to come specifically to the question as to the commissioners, it's the old adage, if you ask people they will say they always want more money. I think COVID and the challenges that threw up required, particularly in relation to the two commissioners that answer to my committee, a really thorough look about how the work was done. And I think that if we look at the Ethical Standards Commissioner, there was an explosion of cases that had to be dealt with, that had to be processed properly, following the requirements of statute, following the obligations that sit upon the commissioner, and had to be done properly. And I think that led to them reviewing the personnel that sit behind that. So rather than say, you know, cap the costs, you know, set a minimum, I think there is And then this goes back to who should take responsibility for this. I think it goes back to actually the commissioners having that real deep dive into what it is you're required to do, how do you do it, and how can you make that more efficient.
I understand what you're actually saying there, but if you think about it, you know, the NHS was allocated a 4.3% increase, and the police 5.6 in terms of resources. So they've got to deal with that. Whereas commissioners seem to be in a position, and it's not just, you know, ethical standards, they're all coming in with very significant increases in funding, and then we've got, you know, another half a dozen in the pipeline, and that's one of the things that we as a committee are trying to address. So that's why I'm looking to see, you know, how, you know, if people say, well, hold on, so frontline services like NHS have got to work within a within an envelope, right? Why should commissioners not be in the same kind of place?
I think my sense is that certainly the commissioners that come before my committee understand they are working within an envelope. You know, however, the experiences that they've had have shown that, in essence, the vehicle that was being used to work within that envelope was perhaps not as fit for purpose as perhaps it should have been. And there are proposals, you know, from both commissioners about how you, in essence, I use the word streamline, that sort of, you know, suggests, you know, not cutting corners, but making a more efficient organisation. I think there's an obligation on that. I think as to the costs and the risk of the exponential spread of it, you need to look at what it is that the commissioners are doing. Freedom of information is very important in Scotland. It's used a lot. There is, you know, a level of criticism that subjectively people suggest it's a group of people who are constantly doing it, or it's another group that are constantly doing it. But when you look within the FOI legislation, it's also about moving to a period of transparency that's at the point of the delivery of it to reduce the FOIs. So there is a route map, but it requires a change in almost groupthink of certain organisations. When you look at the ethical standards, Commissioner, they are the backstop to the ethical standards that we, along with councillors, along with various public appointments, you know, people should act for. And you have to ask your question, do we need someone to judge that? And historically, sadly, it is useful to have someone to be that judge. The consequence of that, or to be that assessor, let me say, rather than judge. And in order to do that, there is a funding requirement that goes with it, because the cases are becoming more complex, the existence of social media platforms and things like that. So, again, the easy answer, I think, is to say that's your set budget, that's it. I think the real answer is to say what is it that we want them to do, and to empower the committees not to step on the independence, but to provide that critical oversight to see where there's value for money. And then that goes back to the blockage point that I was talking about, that in a sense I think there are parts that are falling between the paving stones, which we've seen can cause massive problems. And if they were avoided and had been avoided for a period of time, maybe we would be in a different position with regard to the outlay.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, Convener. It is clearly public money, and we have to be mindful of that. I think we're in a very challenging environment, and I think spiralling costs, when the public see that, they find that we're a little bit disconnected from reality when the Parliament carries on spending like that. So we do need to have much more accountability. And as said already, it's the SPCB that has those governance procedures around that, the role of Auditor General and inspecting the annual accounts. But there needs to be a sense of reality check from many of these offices about the tight financial envelope that we're all working in, would be my steer to that. But, you know, Martin's alluded to it many times about how the commissioners are independent. And I think it would be difficult for us to pick in around some of the budget areas as the sort of scrutiny body in terms of the activity they're carrying out and driving and making judgments about the value that they're bringing from their spend from some. But it might be easier. I know you're looking quizzical, and I'm trying to form my bill.
Okay. That's one of the things that we're trying to grasp. The kind of how we evaluate the difference that these commissioners make, i.e. if a commissioner wasn't there, what would the difference be? So, for example, you know, in terms of children and young people, what would the difference be, for example, and could the work be done by, you know, by, you know, government or any other organisation? You know, and there's issues of democratic accountability as well, of course.
I think the role of the Children and Young People's Commissioner is specifically is about making, giving voices to the young people, which is something that government makes assumptions about. I think even the other week when she was giving evidence to us, I think some of our questions were quite challenging about things that maybe we presume to be important. But again, she kept bringing us back to the point, no, I'm here making representations on the people, what the young people have said. And I think that was quite clear in reinforcing that argument. And the assumptions that we can make are quite sweeping sometimes when it comes to the challenges that young people are facing today and all these things. But it might be there's a position, you go back to the budgets and the spend and sort of that fine balance between the value add, which you would struggle to maybe pinpoint, but there's certainly potentially the chance some of the more tangible things, travel, spending, on those sort of ancillary items, we could perhaps be a little bit more critical about if that's looking to be something that accelerates. But can I want to make sure, I just want to, something that was put in as part of the Commissioner's evidence, and I think as a committee we hear far too often about this massive implementation gap that's there between policy and what's actually happening on the ground. And their evidence sort of outlines the fact that they think that the creation of another body or person to champion these needs of a particular group appears to be a reaction to ineffective policy implementation and access to justice. So I think we need to be mindful about how we proceed with a exponential, whether it be growth in number of commissioners or the exponential growth in the budget that's taking place.
Yeah, I mean, there's a perception of gaps, but there's also concerns about duplication and overlap. Okay, I'm going to open up the session to colleagues around the table, and the first will be Liz, followed by Ross.
Thank you. Can I ask Ms Webber, do you think that the increasing demands for the work of the Children's Commissioner has come about because of failure within the educational system?
I think I kind of alluded to that there in terms of that massive gap that people are seeing in terms of policy and then how it actually feels to the young people on the ground. And there's a massive disparity in that. And the advocacy role that they play in championing the rights of those children.
Could you give us some examples of where you think that there is this huge gap in terms of the lack of delivery against what was promised?
The only one that springs to mind right now might be our additional support for learning, but I'm afraid I can't really talk an awful lot about that until tomorrow.
What do you think the Commissioner was arguing in terms of, given the evidence that you cited that she had given to your committee, what do you think she was citing as some of the gaps in the delivery?
I'm not certain that the Commissioner spoke an awful lot about that specifically to us, because it was about her strategy going forward, because she was taking a new approach. But I think in the past, you've heard, whether it be the gaps in the promise that's there, you know, the care experience, young people that still feel let down. We had an informal session with them and we heard some quite critical voices, and that's the role of the Commissioner to champion those voices as well.
I mean, I think our perspective at the moment is to look at how effective the Commissioner landscape actually is. And when it comes to particular commissioners, I mean, obviously, if we're looking at this from the statistics that reflect what is happening to children and young people just now, whether that's poverty or it's attainment, or it's those who are able to fight their case, which is a difficult thing for children and young people. The statistics are not terribly impressive that we are doing a better job with young people. And therefore, that's quite a challenge. And what we've got to identify as a committee is to whether that has come about because the commissioners are not doing a very good job, or whether it's actually public services that are failing instead.
I think it was most the information we get a sense of is that the services are failing, whether it be the evidence we took in the Transitions Bill as well and our scrutiny around that, There was also the recent evidence that we took from the Commissioner in relation to the Children's Care and Justice Bill, in terms of the secure accommodation. There's mismatches in what is actually happening on the ground and what the reality or what the intention of the policy is. The mismatch is quite vast and it seems to be growing. And the Commissioner does highlight those. But again, I'm sitting here trying to think with the new Commissioner, but I'm also looking back retrospectively. The previous outgoing Commissioner was quite critical of many of the government policies when he was there and did shine a real spotlight on, and was very critical of the development and implementation. So I think I'm in that position where we've got the transition of a new Commissioner, so I'm trying to figure out the best way to respond to that. In the past, I think the previous Commissioner was very, very, very challenging of.
Yeah, I mean, the previous Commissioner gave evidence to the committee, and I think it is about this gap that is important in this debate because the gap matters, obviously, matters to the lives of children and young people, but I think it matters to the conclusions that we come to as to whether the Commissioner and the oversight that he or she has is the problem or whether it's a problem of failure within the system. And I just want to raise with Mr. Whitfield, you obviously represent two completely different scenarios here because Ms. Webber is dealing with a commissioner who's obviously the main interest is advocacy. And Mr. Whitfield, you're dealing, as you rightly said, about regulation and investigation. Do you think that these differences in the roles that commissioners have change the public perception about whether they are being successful or not?
I think that's a very interesting question. I think I will go back to the choice of having a commissioner back at the turn of the millennium in relation to the ethical standards and also freedom of information, because commissioners were seen as being independent of government, much more so than independent of parliament. And the requirement for that was to give them a level of authority that would allow them to act in the quasi-judicial role that they do. The ethical standards in commissioners' involvement with regard to MSPs meant that they, of course, had to be independent of the parliament, but also had to be seen to be distinctly independent of the parliament. And that needed a phrase to carry a weight. And at the time, the concept of a commissioner at that time was different perhaps to what it is now. And whether or not in that intervening period, the public's view of what a commissioner is, or indeed what a commission is, has changed so substantially as to undervalue or perhaps reinforce the value of someone independent, certainly of government, and I would say also independent of parliament, to undertake the roles that by statute we've given them in respect of those that answer to my committee. I think the annual reports, conversations with the commissioners, the interaction with people who interact with the commissioners is such that there's still an understanding of those that apply for the FOI adjudication or those that come through the Ethical Standards Commissioner understand the role, the importance, the significance and the independence of it much more than the general public do. Yeah.
On that point, and it's my, and I've got no scientific evidence for this whatsoever, but in my 17 years in this place, it is my impression that through casework, the public has a good understanding and relatively appreciative of the work that these commissioners are doing. Do they actually solve the problems? I think that's more difficult. And I just wonder, in relation, you raised the question about COVID earlier and how that had considerable implications. Do you feel that the public perception with the Information Commissioner or Ethics and Standards is actually dealing with the issues satisfactorily?
I think in some ways, to look at the Freedom of Information and the Information Commissioner, in part there is a frustration there because there has been an expectation created of an entitlement to information that perhaps doesn't sit accurately with what the entitlement is. But I would say, and this goes back to you know, can they do themselves out of a job? With regard to freedom of information, a substantial part of the Commissioner's work is shifting that fundamental balance, in essence, to publish and open up so that the information is there, so that constituents, and you know, when I think about my own caseload and others, that they actually have the best understanding of why a decision was made as is possible. And I think with the Ethical Standards Commissioner, I think the role is slightly different in a sense, because it is for elected members on one level to get it right and to understand the importance and the privilege and the Nolan principles that we talk about. And the reason for the Commissioner was to be the guardian, the independent guardian of those for the people of Scotland. So I think the Ethical Standards Commission, if we purely look at that responsibility for the standards of elected members, would be more than glad to do themselves out of the job. However, that onus rests elsewhere.
I'm sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ross, before by John.
Thanks, Convener. I'm conscious that we're holding this inquiry while there's a wider debate going on marking the 25th anniversary of the Parliament around Parliament's capacity, and the presiding officer, Myrtle Fraser, both suggested that we look again at a number of MSPs, particularly in relation to our overall capacity to do committee scrutiny. And Mr Whitfield, you said something interesting a minute ago about the vehicles available to Parliament for scrutiny and accountability of the commissioners aren't really sufficient. Is that purely a comment in relation to capacity, or do you think there are other structural and process issues that we could reform without opening up that? I say without opening up the wider capacity question, it does need to be opened up, but for plenty of other reasons.
Absolutely, and it's always worth to say happy birthday to any institution, but particularly a parliament. It is not just it's not just a capacity within the MSPs or the simple numbers game. There are structures that exist within this, within the parliament. The criticism against the committee system that seems to be levelled by people who were here and are no longer here is always welcome to have that debate. I think the challenge with regard to commissioners boils down to the level of responsibility, in that the budget comes from one legal entity. The scrutiny of the role of the commissioner rests with the parliament and rests with committees. And actually, to do that, I'm not suggesting put the functions together, but I think the oversight committee and the responsibility has to be very specific, and the vehicles have to exist to hold the whole thing to account, to be able to see into it. The blockages that I were talking about was actually about having some system where early, you know, when on that management, when it goes from green to amber, there is a role for an oversight committee to be asking questions. Because of the independence of commissioners, it's very much a difficult area to get into. But the independence of the commissioners that answer to my committee is the independence in their investigation, in their conclusions and in their report, not necessarily in the way that the organisation of that commissioner operates.
It's fine, Mr. Greer. And I was just, I mean, in terms of digging in and getting a bit more detail about the Children's Commissioner, is the challenge is the work plan that we all have to work towards as an education committee. And specifically, we've got a very heavy legislative agenda, which does prevent us from doing anything proactively with the Commissioner to maybe go into more detail about some of the work they're doing, if you wanted us to have that increased level of scrutiny. So in terms of the capacity of the existing system, then perhaps it does need to be reviewed. But it doesn't necessarily mean to be another committee. It just means maybe the whole work plan of the Parliament needs to be reviewed, and maybe do, and this may not be a convener comment, but maybe me, it's more of a leaner legislative programme that allows us to do things a bit more in depth and have more of a proactive agenda on the committees.
The Local Government Committee's written submission to us suggests that they think there would be a benefit to more direct scrutiny of the Commissioner budget separate from overall scrutiny of SPCB's budget. Now, there's nothing immediately stopping any committee from deciding to do direct scrutiny like that, but it's not ordinarily the case. I'm wondering what your both of your thoughts would be on that, because on the one hand you could say it would allow for a more effective level of scrutiny that's currently the case, given the incredibly condensed timescale that we already have around budgets and the wide range of other responsibilities that every committee has, though, I imagine it would immediately come up against a very acute version of the capacity issues that we've just been discussing. Do you have any thoughts on that specifically, that separating out, at least for the purposes of scrutiny, separating out the commissioner budgets from the overall SPCB budget and specifically assigning committees to that as a specific part of their overall budget scrutiny?
Do you want to go first, Martin? I think
it's an interesting proposal, because I think there does need to be scrutiny out with the existing scrutiny. As is always the case, put aside the resource implications at the moment. I think if that had occurred and had been conducted enthusiastically, I think some of the challenges that have occurred over commissioners in the past would have been spotted earlier, if I'm honest. I think it would have come out, because I think as well as the level of formal scrutiny that takes place, there is that interaction that exists between commissioners and committees at different levels and in different ways, which, you know, would allow concerns to be raised that could then be explored. I think one of the challenges is compartmentalising everything the way we do. What we miss is the bringing that together, the overview, which at the end of the day, committee scrutiny is about. It's about having a level of oversight where you can look at the whole picture and pick up either the alarm bells, but also what's working well.
So I just, whatever it was, or however it was to lie in terms of that budget scrutiny, Mr. Greer, I just think wherever it lands, the responsibility is we have to make sure that that can be delivered and it's done well, and there's the time given to do that. So that's about all I would say on that one. I think, you know, it's... Mm-hmm.
Just finally on capacity, if every one of the currently proposed commissioner models was to be agreed to, what impact would that have on your committee workloads? Thinking of, you know, as a member of the Education Committee, I'm aware some of these proposed commissioners, whether it's for disabled people or learning disability, neurodiversity and autism, there's obviously direct relationships with substantial areas of scrutiny that the committee's been doing. Do you think that would aid the committee's ability to scrutinise, or would that place an additional, would that displace other important work because there would then be an obligation to scrutinise the work of those commissioners?
I think your question has answered itself, Mr. Greer. I think it would be a challenge for us to fit it into our work plan anyway. But the overlap that would come from that, I mean, the Children's Commissioner represents disabled children as well, children that are neurodivergent. She is responsible for advocating for all of those people. So I think there is far too much overlap, and it would cause conflict for the young people as well, as to know who would be their advocate and who would be the best place to serve them going forward, never mind the additional complexity it would place upon scrutiny within the committee system and the Education Committee.
Thank you.
I think just to come in on that, I think that goes back to the challenge of commissioners straddling committees. I think there is, I mean, obviously the committee system, apart from the statutory committee, loosely reflects the government, and that makes it problematic with regard to commissioners. And I think one of the things that would help with any commissioner is that there is a specific committee that is assigned to do the oversight, and that would be all of the oversight, because otherwise you find stuff will just shift between the two, and rightly committees will take what interests them. Whereas that level of scrutiny is lost in that case.
Convener?
John? Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, maybe just following on from that, I mean, another model that has been suggested to us is, and it probably wouldn't affect some of your areas, Mr. Whitfield, but the Scottish Human Rights Commission being given a bit more power on the one hand, and then it would do overall human rights for all of these things. So disability and children and everything would all fall within that, and they might have separate rapporteurs and so on. I mean, I don't know if either of you have any views how that would affect, because the issue of complexity, which you've just mentioned, yeah, Ms. Webber.
Mr. Mason, I suppose it goes back to the role that the Children's and Young Persons Commissioner is that they're specifically about voices or hearing the voices of all the young people without the assumptions that adults might make. And the current commissioner is specifically looking proactively to go out and find ways to engage with some of those groups that you've discussed there, that in make sure their voices are being heard. I think having unwielding, might not be the right word, but a massive commissioner with a remit that's as broad and as wide as that will not allow the advocacy to be there for the young people who often feel unheard at the best of times without them being diluted. I mean, within everything else, I think that's the key thing, I think, that sets them apart.
Do you think then, because young people don't have a vote, that there's a special argument for their commissioner?
I think it's irrelevant if they've got a vote or not, Mr Mason. I think young people deserve someone to have their voice in here, irrespective of that.
But don't disabled people?
Yes, and disabled young people are also covered by the Children and Young People's Commissioner. As I said previously, the Children's Commissioner is for every young person, able-bodied, yes, disabled, whatever their position might be.
Okay, but then the argument, if I take devil's advocate, for disabled people is that, well, not all disabled people are children, so they still need a commissioner, even though there would be an overlap with the Children's Commissioner.
That's not perhaps... It's not something I would... I'm here as a convener of the committee, and yes, I'm struggling not to have my view as my party view here, yes, Mr Mason, but thank you for your question.
Yeah,
I'll just leave it.
I realise that's one of your colleagues. I mean, and others' witnesses today have already said when they're speaking for the committee and when they're speaking for themselves, so I think we can take that on board if you want. Yeah, I've mentioned specific cases, but I suppose my underlying problem or question is, how do we, on the one hand, not have what you've described, this huge organisation covering everything, but on the other hand, not having so much overlap? Because it does seem that the more commissioners we have, the more overlap there will be. And I think your committee would be one which might suffer from that.
We already do, I think. I suppose the commissioner said that. There's areas of overlap which prevents them from going in and carrying out investigations and inquiries because of existing overlap, albeit it's peripheral around the edges. I can't remember the specific details, we've got some of it, but I think there is already existing overlap in terms of the public bodies that are responsible for carrying out specific functions that prevents the Children and Young People's Commissioner from carrying out investigations. So adding more complexity to that and more commissioners to that and more areas of overlap, to me, would be a big red flag.
Okay. Mr Whitfield, I mean, you've suggested that, you know, that a commissioner should report to a committee, and that might kind of simplify the system. Another suggestion that's come to us has been that the committee and the commissioner should be working more kind of hand in glove together and see themselves as doing the same work. It was suggested that the committee should kind of assign work to the commissioner. Have you any thoughts around that space?
I would go back, and this is specifically about the commissioners that report to my committee or are overseen by my committee. The independence of those commissioners is crucial because of the questions that come in front of them and what they do. What I would say is there is something, and if we look at the FOI, there's a series of steps that happen before it goes to the information commissioner, which is someone puts in an FOI, the organisation then look at it and advance it, insufficiently. There's then an appeal within that. So there is a very structured process of how a constituent goes from wanting to know what the outflow of rubbish into a bay is, from when they first pose that letter all the way through to when they feel they need to go to the commissioner. And that is very clearly articulated. And so the numbers that actually come to the commissioner at the end of the day for a decision are a tiny minority to those that went in at the system. Now, because of that quasi-judicial process, it's different to the advocate's role, in a sense, as a commissioner, where the advocate's role is to give voice to a group that otherwise can't participate in a system, or as individuals feel that they're being stopped from participating in that system. And I think there is a lot to be said for articulating the value, be it whether they have a vote or don't have a vote, about what it is in the system that they're not being able to contribute to. And I think, you know, if you look at the Children's Commissioner, I think over a number of commissioners, one of the things that has constantly been raised is the fact that they know how you engage with young people so that young people can contribute to a discussion. And it is very rarely the formality of a committee room like this. I think that role in advocacy is massively important because it's the individualisation of that access. Whereas in the commissioners, the answer to mine on all of them, there is a very, very set process that you go through that actually takes out a vast number, amount of work, so that when you get to the commissioner, you're in essence at the top of the pyramid. You're a hand, not a handful of cases, but the cases that go there for reasons.
Yes.
And that then leads to the investigation. And then what becomes important is the learning circle back about how you avoid it. And that sits with my committee with regard to MSPs about the code of conduct.
Okay,
and the guidance.
And sticking with your committee, we have both the Ethical Standards Committee and the Standards Commission.
Yes.
Sorry, Commission. Do we really need both? They both defended themselves when they were here, but I remain unconvinced that we need two.
So, you're now drifting out of the cover of my... you're drifting out of what my committee does, but there is a question about... There are elements in it, which is, firstly, the investigation to identify the collection of facts on which a decision will be made. Then you have the next step, which is, you know, a human right. It is natural justice that actually somebody, an institution out with that, looks at it to make sure that the process has been done correctly and that it's done. So is there a need for more than one? Yes, because if you take away some of those, what you will end up with is people going to court and, you know... At the end of the day, that is an option that is open, you know, almost to anybody who goes through any of these processes. And, you know, once you go to court, there are no winners. So it is about ensuring that the process is as robust as possible. So do you need two separate ones? Well, if you didn't have two separate ones, you would still need something that reflected the rules of natural justice about how it is for those individuals, be it councillors, or the role that exists for, you know, colleagues that sit in this place.
Okay, I still remain unconvinced. Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. Are there any further points you wish to make before we wind up the session?
One small thing, convener, is just I think what we would be concerned about is that if more commissioners were brought into the mix, it would cause further confusion and make things a bit more ineffective even further for young people to be able to figure out who it would be that they could go to be their champion. And, of course, comes with that costs. I'm sure that's one of your causes, but also creates more barriers for justice if there's more confusion in the landscape. So that's my final word.
Okay, thanks, Martin.
My final word, really, I suppose, is to go back to the very interesting question of the use of the word commissioners in the sense of what the role is that they fulfil. And actually, you know, if you understand what your problem is, you can find a solution. I think sometimes we're struggling to understand what the problem is, and we perhaps impose a solution. So I'll just leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for your contributions this morning. We'll continue taking evidence in relation to our inquiry at our meeting on the 21st of May. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. Our next item on our agenda, which we'll discuss in private, is consideration of our work programme. So just have a 2-minute break to enable our witnesses and official report to leave.